Good afternoon to one and all present here. It is a glorious moment to extend my warm wishes on behalf of the principal and staff of St. Xavier's School, Bathinda, and convey our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Vijay Chechi, Head and Professor, School of Education, Lovely Professional University. He holds a degree in MA Economics, MEd, and PhD Education, and has 17 years of prior experience working for Lovely Professional University, and is still an integral part of the institution. Thank you, sir, for accepting the invitation and presiding over this webinar. And today, he would enlighten us on national education policy. Thank you, sir.
I welcome in this session to all the present teachers from the St. Xavier School. I have been invited to talk on the national education policy and how this policy is going to change the future of India in the education sector. So that is the viewpoint with which I would be sharing with my views on this thing. And if I talk about that national education policy, that how it came across, what is the need that after such a long period of time and we find this policy coming into force, there are a lot of discussions we have seen, might be from your side also, your principal and your teachers might have been interacted on the people, those who were involved in this policy document. So it was basically in 2015 when the United Nations had worked on the sustainable development. We have a lot of issues with our earth or in human development as such. There are different problems that we are facing, and the all those problems that were there that the world was facing, either it is in the developed country or the underdeveloped world or the developing nations, those areas were identified and it was collectively agreed upon by all the nations that these are the areas and in which these will be the benchmarks on which we are going to ascertain whether a country is moving toward sustainable development or not. We have seen a lot of issues with respect to sustainable development, either it is energy or it is automotive or it is climate. We are all talking on those issues, but nobody is talking about the education. So that was the one major focus with which this policy came, because the government of India also became the signatory to this sustainable development goals in the United Nations. And the fourth sustainable development goal, what we call as SDG 4. Now this is the main one aspect, that is the quality education. Now looking into the education sector that we are having, now you all are mostly, you will be either the Bachelor of Education graduates or some of you might have done the Masters of Education. You have the primary classes, but I'm sure not many of you have done the DLED, Diploma in Elementary Education, or the Bachelor in Elementary Education. And might be none of you would have done the Nursery Teacher Training Program. So that is the focus of the sustainable development, that it is not the case of India only, it is the case of the world at large, that we are overlooking the elementary education as a, in totality. And if I talk about in terms of the school education, now what this sustainable development goal has focused upon, there are 10 goals that have been focused upon for the quality education. And out of them, which are related to basically towards school education. So therein we have most of the things that we already had, but there is one peculiar shortcoming is there, and that is with respect to the elementary education. Now, if I talk about the firstly, the different goals, the targets that have been asked for under this goal, the firstly, it is the free, equitable, and quality primary education. Now, this primary education for all boys and girls, but at present also we can find out that if we talk about the just the data of the when our right to education was enforced in 2010, we still find that all the 100% children are not enrolled into the school education. Forget about the elementary, they are not even enrolled into that. Then second is the all girls and boys must have the access to quality early childhood development and pre-primary education. Now this is specific which we talk at the kindergarten. We you might have your kindergarten school wing in your school, and we treat it very in a very short coming way that how much importance we are giving to that. We are not giving at all. We are not deputing our very quality teachers onto that sector. We are overlooking that area. That just because we are just thinking that teaching the alphabets, the teaching the numbers is the just the requirement of that age. We are not looking on the problem solving. We are not looking on the creativity on that aspect. So this is the one of the major area which is reflecting in the national policy document. Then we talk about the changes that is going to be there in the curriculum of the our secondary classes, our primary classes and the middle classes. That is the equal access of all the children with respect to their vocational training, with respect to their education, and all persons either belonging from any category, either caste, creed, disability, and grouping, all the tribal, everybody should have the similar opportunity for education. Then all learners must acquire the knowledge and skills to promote sustainable development. So that sustainable development meaning thereby whatever we have talked about the in the slide of 17 sustainable development goals, there should be education related to that. Then we want to upgrade the facilities in our schools, because today we do not use the term special education. Today we use the term inclusive education. Now that inclusivity, what does it mean actually? We have to take care of all the children, all disabilities, all retardedness, all type of problems that the children may have. All children has to be there in the same class. RTE education, when it stipulates that you have to consider the age of the child. You do not have to consider his qualification or his mental ability. You have to consider the age of the child to give him admission in a certain class. If a child is of 12, so you have to give him an admission in class 6 or 7. But he will not, if he has gone through some education or not, that does not matter. So that is the right to education, and that is also becoming a partner to this inclusivity. Now these were the goals which have come up. I would not go into this slide because that is all about the history coming up from the independent India and how does we have come up with the national policy on education. I had already focused upon that why national policy on education has come up in 2020. This is just a 5 year back signed by the Indian government on the UN document. As a result of that, we are changing the educational system as a whole. So this vision document of national education policy states that we want to make India-centric education. Now, what does this India-centric education mean? The India-centric education means that we are going to correlate the cultural values, the traditional knowledge that we are having into the education system, into the curriculum of the different classes. So this, so as to transform our nation into a sustainable, equitable, and vibrant knowledge society. So that is the focus of this policy document. About on different terms. One was the state school standard authority. Now presently we are finding in that these schools, the private schools, the government schools run in totally separate compartments. The private schools are not in talk with the government schools. We feel them as inferiors in respect to the quality intake. And if we talk about the teachers, they look upon the government teachers, look upon the private teachers in, from a different angle. So there is a one provision for that, that the there will be a state school standards authority that is going to rate each and every school in the state, and there will be benchmarked on certain parameters, and you can claim what we see in newspapers that we are the best school in Jalandhar or we are the best school in Punjab. Now those kind of things are going to be with some factual information on this website. Then second thing is the national professional standards for teachers. Now this is the another point that is going to come up. Today we are becoming the teachers and we are qualified the B.Ed. We have done the teacher eligibility test and once and for all I am the teacher for my whole life. Now that is going to change. We are going to make the teachers go for standardization again and again after a certain period of time. This phenomena is already there in the developed countries where there is a benchmark of 5 years or 7 years that after that you have to become certified again with respect to your teaching subject. But here we are not finding that thing. So this is the National Professional Standards for Teachers, which is going to work upon all these things to make the certification necessary in all schools. Number one, the teacher eligibility test is going to be made compulsory for all. Then there will be rankings of the teachers, and also that certification will be for a certain period of time. Then there is a teacher education institution reforms, which is talking about, you had already heard in your newspapers that there will be a more impetus going on for the 4-year integrated B.Ed. program, whereas the 2-year standalone programs are going to be stopped and the standalone teacher education institutions are going to be removed slowly and slowly, and only the programs, teacher education programs, will be going to be run into the system of integrated disciplines. So this is going to be the phenomena that is going to come up in the future. Then there will be no compartmentalization of the subjects. Just like we are saying, I am a BSc graduate, another you are saying, I am a BA graduate, another one is saying, I am a BCom graduate. So that compartmentalization is going to be removed. Anybody can have a bachelor degree in any discipline. He can choose one subject from the sciences, he can choose another from the commerce, and another from the arts. So there will be, you will be seeing that our children are going to be saying that he is a graduate. Now, graduate in what subject, then he is going to specify his subjects. He's not going to tell, I am a BSc or I am a BCom or I am a BA. So he's not going to tell us like that. So there will be the compartmentalization of the disciplines or the streams is going to be stopped. From the 6th onwards, the change is going to be there. Then there is a lot of the technological use is going to be there by the government in order to monitor lot of things. Either it is the enrollment or it is the achievement of the learners or it is the teachers, recruitment, everything is going to be monitored by the government. Then the another major point that has been there in the documents, policy documents earlier also, the mother tongue and the home language, that the initial classes of elementary as well as the kindergarten are going to be taught through the mother tongue or the home language. So that is still not very clear, but because the always India is a land where there are number of languages are there, the mother tongue is for states, different states are different, and there is a unifying language of Hindi and English. So where somewhere it is the official language is considered as English as priority, or in some other the Hindi is considered as a priority. So it is still in the debate that how it is going to be coming up into picture after some time, so that we have to see. The another part is that we have the national curriculum framework for early childhood care and education that is going to be there, which is coming in very, very big way. And that is going to be the one area where the government is going to have a massive recruitment in the coming years. And there is the, now today we talk about the Anganwari workers. Now those Anganwari workers are going to be replaced with the people, those who are qualified to teach the early childhood children. Then there is this mission for literacy. and numeracy, what we have seen in our ACER reports, annual survey on education report, every year this NGO comes up with the Pratham organization comes up with the data that the achievement of the learners with respect to their language, with respect to their numerical ability is very low. Now that is going to be worked upon as a mission, and there will be workshops, there will be modules for teachers as well as for the learners, the e-content material that is going to be coming free for all the teachers. So this is going to be the another mission that the government is looking for. Then there is the 1 year preparation program for ECCE for all different people, either they are the graduates or they are already working, they are going to have a program for that. Then is the early vocationalization, that is you have to start with lot of programs in your classes, in your schools from sixth onwards, which is going to look upon into the change of curriculum where you have to supposedly make a 10-day work for internship for the children in outside world. Either it can be in the agriculture, or it can be in the with the electrician, or it can be with a carpenter, or it can be with a software engineer, but anything that can make the child understand the nitty and gritties of certain professions which are skill oriented. So that is early vocationalization is going to be started by the schools. Then is the competency based education that is going to be talked upon for the children also and the teachers also. The students' competencies has to be identified. There has to be a card which is going to be worked upon as an online form, wherein each and every child from the start of the class 1 till his class 10th, every year that is going to be filled up by the teachers, that what competencies the student has acquired, what abilities he had garnered. So all those things are going to be coming up in this system. Then the another aspect that is going to be coming up in the school sector that is in a big way by 2022 is the PARAKH. Now this is again an evaluation plan. Now that is again monitored by the teachers and by the government, that how the things can be evaluated in new innovative ways. There will be training for the teachers. There will be staff in order to conduct the online based testing, in order to conduct the teaching, in order to conduct the evaluation for different type of exams, either they are objective or they are subjective or they are open book system. So those kind of things the plan in evaluation plan are thought to be by coming up into the system of education by this policy document. Then exam reforms are related to this only, that we are presently focusing upon lot of on the subjectivity. You have been into the online mode of teaching now, and the way that you are assessing your children are now mostly objective. You're conducting their monthly tests on objective basis. You're conducting their the term end exams with this objective evaluation, and you are just on the faith of the parents that the child is not going to cheat, is using this time bound manner in order to assess the children. Now where is the assessment from subjective point of view? Might many of you are satisfied with the evaluation, but there is the another point that this year this pandemic has led to the levels of learning to a degraded level. Now that is one aspect, but the examination reforms are going to come up, that there must be the plan that what things are to be evaluated from objective point of view and what things will be evaluated from subjective point of view, along with the other vocational parts, that vocational skills that we are going to introduce in our schools, how they are going to be evaluated. So there will be specific guidelines related to that is going to come up into the future. Now, first and foremost, that foundational literacy and numeracy mission that I was talking about. Now, this foundation is what? The foundational mission that is talked about is the early 5 years. Now, what this early 5 years, we are presently going with the nursery, then lower KG, then upper KG, then the child moves into the class one and then goes into the class second. Now, we used to conduct this convocation ceremony for the children from KG to the school. Some of the private schools does that also, the convocation ceremony after the completion of the kindergarten. Now that has to be introduced for 2 years away now. You have to have a bunch of five classes together from kindergarten till the second. So that 5 years, then you have to another 3 years for your middle stage, primary stage, that is third, fourth and fifth class, which is going to be the extension of the pedagogical styles that you are going to use in your kindergarten in the next classes. The moment the child moves into the sixth class, into the middle stage, the pedagogical aspects are going to change differently. Now that is slightly related to the primary stage, but during that stage, the scenario of the children will be that they have to go for internship, they have to go for vocational skills, they have to go for some kind of choosing in the subjects. By the 8th standard, there will be a wide variety of choices. From 9th onwards, 9th to 12th, there will be a choices of subjects from interdisciplinary phenomena. That is going to be from the physics, or one another can be the accounting, the another can be the language. So that is going to start from the 9th to 12th. So that foundational literacy is the first thing that is going to come up. The another aspect is that you have to start for the vocational aspects with internships. Then you have to talk about the holistic progress record card. That is going to talk about the holistic development, though in CBSE schools we are still finding in there lot of things that we are doing, but the way they are being done is the area which needs to be more focused approach by the schools as well as the board. Then we are talking about this, the 10 plus 2 system, what we are talking about now, it becomes the 15 year system. Now it is not just the 12 year system. Now this is the system that I am talking about, that we are going to have the kindergarten plus your 2 years of primary into one sector, which will be called as the foundational stage of your school. Then another stage will be your preparatory school, which is primary, you can call in other words. And then there will be the 6 to 8 and the 9 to 12 senior secondary. They have not been touched upon, but yes, the blocks has been created. You will find more number of schools into the senior secondary mode in your in future than just with the secondary. So that the senior secondary word is going to be missing. That is not going to be used. The 9 to 12 stage will be considered as a secondary stage only. Now this is the change that we are going to have, and this academic structure is focused upon the pedagogical part. Earlier policy documents had never talked about that, what shall be the pedagogical styles that we need to use in with these this stage. Now herein, the curriculum of the teacher education programs related to these levels are going to go with a drastic change. And at the foundational level, it talks about just play and activity. Just two things, not more than that. You have to introduce play and activity based activities in your kindergarten and in your class, first and second class. During the place as in the preparatory stage, you need to talk about little bit of factual material along with the same play and the activity based. But going into the middle stage, the experiential learning will be focused upon, because this is the stage when the child is going to go into for internship for 6 to 10 days in his neighborhood to learn about the nitty-gritties of his choice of subjects or choice of vocational areas. There will be all type of subjects that will be there into this stage, which is having because if I talk about in terms of the environmental science, is still second we have the subject of environmental science, but the moment I go into the primary, it goes shifts into science and social studies. So that is the way that how we are going to move into this direction, that how the secondary stage will be totally different, wherein we have to focus upon the in-depth study, more into the critical thinking, more into the problem solving, and there will be the schools has to think about, because this is one of the concern of the secondary stage, that what the policy document envisions. It talks about that you have to provide as number of choices in your school as possible. Because if you talk about blockchain technology, if you talk about artificial intelligence, if you talk about fine arts, if you talk about accounting, there is a number of subjects that are there. And if you have to have that many of specializations in your school, you need to have work upon the numbers. If you have the numbers, then only the financial viability of these options is possible. Otherwise, the choices that you can make for a child for to identify from different disciplines will be very, very difficult. So this is one of the area where the you will be ranked upon, because the choices that the schools are going to give in for their children to opt for is will be one of the criteria for the ranking of the schools in that particular region. At the foundational stage, now this is very important. The foundational stage, we have to understand that a teacher must be able to teach both in a similar way. So the another important aspect of the teacher point of view, we need to think about the talent identification. We have to think about the processes so that we can make the assessment as learning and assessment for learning of different concepts. And we have to teach through bilingual mode in the early classes. So this is the another important thing that we have been ensuring. I will be the teachers again, we have to work upon why this session has been organized. One of the motive of this thing is that you have to ensure that each teacher must have a 50 hours of training in the year. So that is the aspect of the professional development of the teachers. Then there will be, the aim is that there will be association of the professors or the teacher education institutions with the schools in order to provide the mentoring. Similarly, there will be the professional standards I had already talked about. There will be school management programs for heads, teachers, and community volunteers for at different levels. So this is the going to be the aim that is we are going to see. Then all the private schools will be having the teachers with TET only. This is going to be worked upon. Another thing, that we have been going through a TET which is similar for which is different for primary and the secondary, but now we are going to see there will be four types of TETs for all different levels: foundational, preparatory, middle, and the secondary. There will be four types of TETs are going to come up, and the National Testing Agency is going to be conducting a test on this thing. Then there will be merit-based scholarships will be given for all the teachers, all the children, those who want to go for a teacher education program in future. That is the government policy is there. So there are other guidelines also for book promotion. And there will be this, I had already talked about, technology is going to be utilized by the government in order to have the database for all the students and the teachers. And this is the timeline that is we are expecting. The first major thing was expected is 2021, but still the things are not being in shape, neither the National Curriculum Framework for School Education, neither it is for the National Curriculum Framework for Early Childhood Education. Not all those things are going to be coming up in future. So we have to wait for one more year to see the things coming up into our aspect. But if this policy comes into shape, we will be having universalization of early childhood care. We will see the attainment of the FLN, and we will be seeing 100% enrollment along with the inclusive education or every child's importance and the improvement in the intelligence of all the children. So with this, I expect that some of the basic orientation of the national education policy that is aimed, envisioned in this document is I have been able to share with you what to be working upon.
So one, my last question.
Sure.
It's about the multiple entry and multiple exit. I'm at the university levels. Now, are the universities going to cooperate? Because will it not affect their enrollment? You might have people entering your, you know, four-year program and then might exit right in the middle after a year. Is it going to be effective at the university level? Because you might land up taking 60-odd students in a course, block that number of seats, and by the second year, they have already, you know, they've taken the exit. So how would happen? The universities now, because you're becoming quite a reputed one, how do you think the implementation would on multiple thing which is there to any?
Basically, it is going to improve upon the quality of our institution. When you allow, at present also it is being allowed that if a student comes to us and in the first year, and by the second year he feels that he is not finding the system good one, so he has the choice to move to a next university. So he can move from one university to another university, but the requirements are something different. He has to have some passing requirements and all that. So that is allowed. And that is also making us into a system that we need to work upon more in order to make our child satisfied. So it is, you can say in simple sense, the education has become a consumer oriented. A child is a consumer, and if he is satisfied, he is going to continue with us. And if he is not satisfied, then he is going to move out. That will be there. But the multiple entry into the school system will not be there. It is only I had already started with the same thing, that it is going to be the thing of the numbers. If you are going to have around 600 students in your plus one, you will be able to give them a lot of offerings of the subjects. But if you have just a 50 students, you cannot manage to offer them some 6 or 7 subject offerings. That will not be feasible for you. So that is the basic problem in that implementation of the subject choices. But let's see what the government is going to think about that. And other thing is that if I am not going to able to offer to the children, they are going to move to a new school. That will be the things coming up. So we have to be in a fight for supremacy as a school system, that we have to think about that if we do not meet the quality parameters, the children are going to be to the other school. And if children are going to, our numbers are going to dwindle. And if they are going to dwindle, our survival is going to be at stake. So that is the
Right. Yes, teachers, any other questions? Sir, do we have some raising hands again, sir? Anybody else would like to raise questions? All right. On that note, I would like to request all the teachers that you would be getting a link, which would be sent by the school coordinator, feedback form, and you have to fill it up and kindly submit it before 5 p.m. today. It's a feedback form which requires all the details as email address, name of the participant, your mobile numbers, name of school and institute. Select the date, which date will be mentioned already. You have to just choose that option, 29 January 2021. That is today, 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Your designation. And I'm sure we've heard, sir, so experts presentation style, which was, I can't say more, but I'm, of course, a huge fan, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Experts' knowledge of the subject, overall rating of the seminar workshop, on which topics you would like to attend future seminars and workshops, your feedback, and any other queries. So that form will be, the link will be sent to you in a short while. Kindly wait for that and submit it before 5 p.m. today. And sir, I would again like to extend heartfelt gratitude to you for a lovely session. And indeed, it was very, very informative. Thank you so much, sir, Dr. Professor, Dr. Chechi. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
My only point, Isha, is that if you require any trainings on the pedagogy of different subjects or from different stages, so we can help you out in that.
Definitely, sir. We would look forward to that.
Have a talk with us on that. Right.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for all the help you're extending. Thank you so much, sir.
We'll get back to you. All the staff members and especially to the principal of the school. Thank you.
Definitely. Thank you so much, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Thank you, dear teachers. We call it a day on this note.